Hey there, good people. Brian here, and I don't know about you, but after looking at all of these geographic features of Europe, I'm feeling pretty parched. Luckily for me, we're going to be looking at rivers and waterways today, and luckily for you, they are fascinating, beautiful, and above all, pretty darn interesting. Today we're going to answer three questions. Number one, why does Europe have so many rivers? Number two, what are some of the major rivers of Europe? And number three, what defines these major European rivers? Why does Europe have so many rivers? Just as with Europe's mountains, peninsulas, islands, and landforms, Europe is ridiculously geographically diverse, which is probably a reason why so many people have fought over it for, well, basically forever. Rivers are no different, and for most of them, we look again to our friend glaciation to explain their formation. It's hard to overstate the level to which glaciers have shaped Europe. About 20,000 years ago, the vast majority of the continent was covered with gigantic sheets of ice that you can see here shaded on the map, carving deep valleys, inlets, and gorges. These deep cuts in the land made for natural waterways for melting glaciers as the climate changed and these ice sheets retreated to the mountaintops and the far north. The high mountains, deep valleys, and cold alpine to temperate climates of the continent meant that rivers flowed steadily, contributing to rich soil for thousands of years. The only major change has occurred really over the last 30 years, where the rapid melting of glaciers from Svalbard to the Alps have led to the increasingly inconsistent behavior of rivers and waterways, such as unpredictable flooding or drying up. That being said, now we know where the rivers came from, let's talk about some of these major and very central to Europe's prosperity rivers. What are some of the major rivers of Europe and what defines them? The Volga River. Let's begin with the longest river in Europe, which is way over on the edge of Europe, the Volga River. Both Russian and other Slavic language names for the river are generally translated as moisture or wet. Which sort of makes sense, right? Flowing 2,194 miles through Russia and draining virtually all of European Russia into the Caspian Sea, four of the 10 largest cities of Europe are on its banks, including Volgograd, which was known as Stalingrad during the Soviet era. And speaking of the Soviet Union, during its rule, large locks, dams, and canals were built along the river to provide hydroelectric power and to allow larger ships to use the river to connect with the Black Sea as well as the Caspian. The Danube River. The longest river flowing through Europe outside of Russia, the Danube flows 1,770 miles through 10 countries before draining into the Black Sea. The name, drawn from several Germanic languages, means swift or strong, and it definitely lives up to that reputation, flowing swiftly through four European capital cities: Vienna, Austria; Bratislava, Slovakia; Budapest, Hungary; and Belgrade, Serbia. Beyond being an essential transportation pathway and source of irrigation, the Danube is the primary drinking water supply for 20 million people, mostly in southern Germany. The Rhine River. Coming in behind the Volga and the Danube in length, but most definitely not smaller in importance, the Rhine begins in the Swiss Alps and flows through five countries northwest and into the North Sea. At 765 miles long, it has six major canal systems, or areas which have expanded the ability of ships to move through it, and runs through 13 major German cities, including Mainz, Bonn, and Cologne. Additionally, the river flows through Strasbourg, France, and Basel, Switzerland. The Rhine has been a vital waterway since before the Roman imperial period, and so all along this river you'll see old fortifications, castles, and other ancient structures. In fact, it's so important to so many countries that it has been acknowledged as an international waterway, meaning no one country owns it, since 1815. The Rhone River. Another river beginning in Switzerland, the Rhone, from the Gallic or French word rodondos, meaning to roll, flows from the Rhone Glacier, See what I mean about those glaciers? And through southern France into the Mediterranean Sea. Before the Rhone heads to sunny southern France, however, it travels through the 59-mile-long, 1,000-foot-deep Lake Geneva, making it the largest and deepest lake in Western and Central Europe. After the lake, the Rhone, with its multiple canals and constant dredging due to its shallow nature near the coast, serves as a vital connection between the central French cities of Avignon and Lyon, which are important industrial areas, and the port city of Marseille on the coast. The Seine River. One of the most well-known rivers in Europe due to its course through the city of Paris, which has been an economic and cultural hub for Central and Southern Europe for at least the last 2,500 years. The river flows under a staggering 37 bridges through the city, the sites of the melodramatic endings of 1,000 romantic comedies. In addition to providing a backdrop for sappy romance, the Seine is a shorter river which runs west and slightly north, draining into the English Channel and providing an important shipping connection between Paris and the rest of the world. But, as with most romances, the Seine is a tempestuous river, and historic flooding has been a real issue, prompting 4 water control dams to be built along its path. Even so, as recently as 2003, over 100,000 works of art were moved away from the river due to flooding concerns. Even with those measures and a large-scale dredging project at the mouth of the river in the English Channel, huge floods in 2016 and 2018 still occurred, and many have claimed that a changing climate bears responsibility. The Elbe River. Flowing 680 miles from the giant mountains in the Czech Republic and running through eastern Germany into the North Sea, the Elbe River can hold some of the largest deep-water vessels and creates an important artery from the North Sea to Prague, the capital of the Czech Republic. The Elbe is also noteworthy for the problems which existed around it during the Cold War era, or when Germany was split into two. The river flowed through East Germany, or the German Democratic Republic, before it reached West Germany, and the East would not allow non-Soviet Allied ships to pass. The solution? The Elbe-Seitenkanal, which created a 71-mile bypass and restored traffic when it opened in 1976. The Thames River. For our last river, we leave the continent, but not Europe, and travel to the island of Great Britain to take a look at the Thames. The name, yep, it's pronounced that way, comes from a Breton word which means muddy or dark. Whatever its looks, it serves as England's waterway to the world, as it flows out of the Port of London, one of the top 20 largest ports in the world, and at 215 miles is the longest river in England, and the second longest after the River Severn in Wales. So why talk about it if it isn't even the longest in the UK? Well, its position has made it so central to Great Britain that former English politician John Burns described it as liquid history. Even though it's a sizable river, the discharge rate, or the amount of water that flows out of it into the North Sea, is far lower than average due to the river being heavily used throughout South Central England for farm irrigation and drinking water. In addition to the usage, the Thames is one of the most artificially altered waterways in the world. Due to the tidal changes from the North Sea, the river can rise quickly, and as a result, over 200 miles of walls and embankments have controlled the river's flow, making it a deep tidal canal through most of London. Conclusion. Even though I can't begin to tell you the number of rivers and waterways which we haven't covered, I can say that they are all important, all life-altering, and all part of Europe's geography. With this taste, however, I hope that you'll have a thirst for seeking out more of Europe's rivers and waterways because, after all, I'm gonna tell you to keep exploring.